Good evening and welcome to the Deerfield Selectboard meeting for August 24th, 2016 at 6:30, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Mass. We have a presentation of public hearing for a, I'll read this out.
You actually can't start that until 6:35.
Oh, I gotta wait?
You have to wait 5 minutes. I'm sorry.
Wait 5 minutes. Well, then maybe we could jump down and improve our minutes. From August 2nd, August 10th, and August 17th, 2016.
I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes as written.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any discussion?
No.
That's good. Do you want to do the Franklin, this is Franklin County Solid Waste Management contract approval?
Yes.
I believe you have copies of the cover letters for these contracts in your packet. These are three fairly small contracts that we do every year. One serves as the contract for the third-party inspection of the closed transfer station, or of the transfer station. That adds up to a $150 fee. One is a hazardous waste collection memorandum of agreement. That simply allows the town to take advantage of that service, which I think happens twice a year. There is a budgeted amount in the contract as part of the addendum. And the third is the bigger one, actually. I said small dollar. I lied. It's the FY17 Memorandum of Understanding for Sludge Hauling and Disposal.
Yes.
The costs for this have increased significantly because of the closing of Montague, and that's reflected in the contract. This is one of those cases where we really don't have a choice. We really don't have any other choice for hauling our wastewater or sludge. So.
Do we have an amount on that?
It's actually, looking at the contract, the price fee shows a transportation cost per gallon of 5.93 cents,
yeah.
A disposal cost per dry ton of $350. Given that there could be anywhere from, I have no idea as to what the gallonage of a truck might be.
I think I heard it was around 9,000 gallons every time.
Per truck.
Per truck.
So 9,000 times 5 cents a gallon. And
that's a lot.
Yeah. It's $3,000 or $4,000 at least per run. Mm-hmm. There's also an administrative fee that's 3.5% of whatever the costs are. That fee has a cap of $6,000 per fiscal year, so we won't be expending more than that. And there we are.
There was an article in the paper that talked about Montague hoping to ramp that back up again.
Well, there were two articles, one kind of back-to-back. The first one talked about the really neat things that they were doing at the Montague wastewater facility and the innovation that was being explored. And literally the next day was the article talking about the DEP fine that the town of Montague has to pay as a result of the failure of that same system because they had a release that it was releasing it too high of whatever levels.
Yep.
You know, and so they basically exceeded their permit. That's why I think they closed it down to the outside sources until they can determine the best way to manage it from here forward.
Okay.
We're exploring as many of the other options. Mm-hmm. I know that Keith Milne and I have been talking with a company out of, I think, Virginia. Right, but there's really no forward movement on that. It's going to be a year or two at the minimum before we can see some progress there. Hopefully there's going to be some other options available to the town, but in the meantime, that's what
these are annual contracts.
They are annual contracts.
Do we have something for us to sign this evening?
Yes.
Okay.
There's two copies of each contract. It's basically the back of the front page of each.
All right. Okay. Well, I make a motion that we approve the contracts from the Franklin County Solid Waste Management Control.
Second.
Or management. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All those
discussion?
In favor?
Good.
No. Good.
Yep.
Now you've probably got close enough to 6:35.
Good. So I'll, while we're doing this, I'll open the hearing for public hearing.
Do you want me to read that off while you're signing?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm going to read the public hearing notice. The Select Board, acting as a local licensing authority for the town of Deerfield, has received an application from Zafar Kiani, forgive me if I mangled your name, on behalf of the Deerfield Convenience Store, LLC, for a retail liquor license to sell wine and malt at 513 Greenfield Road. The hearing will be held on Wednesday, August 24th, 2016, at 6:35 p.m. in the hearing room at Town Hall, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Massachusetts, 01373. Written comments will be accepted in the Selectman's office until 4 p.m. on Friday, August 19. Verbal comments will be accepted at the hearing.
So you guys want to come forward? And
good evening.
Good evening.
Hi. I assume we'll declare the hearing open?
We declare the hearing open.
Hello, my name is Frank Caruso. I'm here on behalf of the petitioner, Deerfield Convenience Store, and this is Safir Kiani, who is the owner and the proposed manager. This is a request, as you know, for a wine and malt off-premises license, a package store license. I've known Mr. Safir for almost 6 years now. I've represented him in his other endeavors. He's been involved in package stores for the last 14 years. He's owned them in Springfield. He actually owned one in Mississippi. In all the time he's owned package stores, he's never had an issue with any violation of any kind. He's never been cited by the state or by the city where he's in for any violation. He's also is TIP certified, which is a certification you get in order to understand what you need to ask for. The gas station, I'm sure, hopefully you're all familiar with it and you've been there. You know what shape it was in prior to them purchasing it. This is one of the owners of the property also. They did what they typically do. They came in, they fixed the building up, cleaned it up, and they opened everything up again in order to service the locality. One of the problems in the gas station business, anyone who's involved in it knows, is that it's almost impossible to make a profit selling gasoline.
Absolutely.
So you always need something to supplement that income. So what they're looking for is what they've done in their other stations, where they'll put in a small, very, very small footprint for beer and wine. It won't be the predominant thing that they're selling in the store. It is a convenience store, but this way they can at least supplement what they're getting so they can keep the place open and keep the gas station working. So this is the reason for the addition of the beer and wine license.
I know you've done an amazing job cleaning up, and it's great to have another convenience store in town. It looks really good, and it's well lit when you go in, and I know you've just invested a lot in the gas pumps and getting the lines to the pumps. I know it's not moneymaker gasoline. Years ago, I worked with that, and we never made any money on that. It was all the other stuff that you'd bring people in with the gas and buy, sell other stuff. So I want to thank you for coming to the community and opening up a store. Obviously, selling liquor or wine and malt is serious because, proximity's to schools, and it's nice to hear that you've never had any other issues at any other places you've been. So
they also understand, because they've done this before, if anything, even if you do approve it tonight, if they do anything wrong, you have the right to just take it away from them.
Correct. Yep. Yep. We definitely don't need any, underage kids with the schools around, and we don't want to lose any kids to drunk driving. For sure, any other reason. So, does anybody else have any comments? Public comments?
Yeah, I'm Rick Russo, and I live right behind the candy kitchen up from where Ken's gas station is.
Sure.
And I grew up there, so I knew Toby Mullins when he owned that gas station forever.
Yep.
And the challenges it takes to make that gas station work.
Yeah.
And I've also known the three subsequent people who have tried to make it go there.
Yeah.
And in the dealings with the proprietor who owns that property is no picnic.
Yes.
If I can leave it at that.
Understood.
diplomatically. So I understand the challenges he faces, and the most recent ones that were pretty blatant. And I'm here to support him on any way that he can legally and viably make his establishment work, and I'd like to put as much support for that as I can, because in the time I've gotten to know him, I found him to be really nice person, very friendly and viable. He works really hard.
Absolutely. I could second that. Thank you very much for your support.
Yep.
Yes, sir.
My name is Richard Arms. How are you doing, Rick?
Hi, how are you?
Good, thanks. So I'm here representing my mother at 8 Main Street, the abutting property to the gas station.
Yeah.
And so we have a different view.
Okay.
We're opposed to the liquor license on a number of reasons. First of all, she couldn't be here today because it's her 88th birthday.
Oh, wonderful.
And she's not moving there quickly, so.
Yep.
Otherwise, she'd be here to argue her own case.
Okay.
My brother's here with me as well, and Winthrop Arms, he lives at the residence as well.
Okay.
So, I guess to start out, we don't see the need for it, given Savage's Market, you know, a stone's throw away, and the river Ridge liquor store up the road, still in Deerfield. So seems a little overkill to have that many establishments selling beer and wine in that location. Not that many people that, you know, live in that area. Second of all, there have been some incidents over the years at that institution, at that location, you know, where there's been actually a murder, very serious, and a number of break-ins over the years. So this might entice further potential criminal activity by those who wish to do that. And second, I think it was mentioned, with the school so close, Deerfield Academy 1, I'm surprised they're not here representing themselves as opposed to this, because, you know, kids will be kids, and kids are older now, especially in private schools, and they have ways of averting, subverting the laws with fake IDs and such. So I wouldn't be surprised if, you know, a PG from Deerfield found their way down there pretty quickly, because it's easy access to see what they could get, and keep trying until they get it. These are just, you know, teenage years, and they're up to doing whatever it is that they can get away with. Not that it's any comment against Deerfield Academy students, but they are teenagers. So those are three points that I wanted to make. And then I guess the fourth one was, yeah, they did a lot of work to the gas station, and they spruced it up and made it nice, and it was fallow for many years. But in so doing, they encroached on our property quite a few feet, and they took down a big maple tree and a bush that that my mother enjoyed looking out the window every day. And then once we surveyed the property, which, if I recollect, in their permit, building permit, they stipulated was to have a certified engineer on site to help with the retaining wall against, you know, our property. Well, it must not have had that. It must not have followed that rule, because they encroached on the property quite a bit, took down a couple of trees. Once we surveyed it, they came back, filled it in, but have not completely removed their encroachment from the property line. So that still sits there. And so nothing's been done since that. But I might call into question, you know, how serious they are about following the town's rules, the state's rules, and the regulations of the Commonwealth.
Has that issue been brought before the planning board, or?
No.
No, zoning board?
No.
Okay.
If I can address some of the things that have been pointed out.
Sure.
First of all, I'm sorry about the encroachment. I did hear about that. My understanding was that when their plans were approved, they followed the line on the plan, and in fact that encroached. I did understand that they did do what they could to fix it.
We did. Actually, excuse me. Let me explain it to you. Actually, we came, when the first time we got the map, map indicated the straight lines. And we followed the same lines toward the last end to this way. As soon as we heard we encroached the property of our neighbors, we did come back to the actual position because it's supposed to be go like little bit zigzag. It's not like whatever that we saw the map from the town of Deerfields. As soon as we heard it's not a straight line, it's supposed to be go like little bit this way. We did it, we did fix the things, we put the things back. And we have, last time we have the things, we can bring some trees and make the fence there. We did it too. And before, when this gas station was there, it's not really, the building is just like the garage and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. You, right now, if you guys go and visit the buildings, we, means we did our best to make this place really very bright. We make entrances. And now is the position, it's not like it used to be. Like windows are very bright, front side. They used to be the, like the garage thing. You can put it down and then you can, you do not know what's going on inside the buildings, what the people's doing inside because everything is covered with things. Now we put the bright windows, everybody knows what's going on inside. Right now the issue is this, since we got this gas station, we make like pennies or two pennies with the gas with the competition of the rest of the neighborhoods.
Right.
We try to survive the things there to try to get the beer and wines, not the whole package things, only beer and wine. At least we can survive there to pay our bills, to pay the mortgage, whatever we spend it there. And if you guys can go and visit the
place. If I can address, I just want to address what he said before we get to this. I can't address what happened with past owners because we have no control over that.
Sure.
Since they were there and fixed it, somebody did break one of their windows. What they've done since, not only do they have a monitoring system, an alarm system, they have a motion detector also. So if somebody breaks a window, tries to come in, it immediately tells the police department. I've told you that they're SIP certified. In 14 years, they've never, ever served a minor. Both the state and ABCC sends people in to shop package stores regularly. The city of Springfield, where we had two stores, does that also. Never, ever did they get caught. In addition, this is we have some people who are coming in to sign that they were in favor of the alcohol being there. And I believe if you look to the station, they are Deerfield police officers. So I would think that they don't have an issue with that either. He does want to be a good neighbor. If the neighbor has any concerns, he can always come and talk to him. He's happy. He's happy
to do
what he can. As far as servicing, the Deerfield has the ability to issue one more license, so it's not fully serviced yet. My understanding is that Savage's Market is closing.
That's what we've
at the end of this month, so they'll be gone. The other station that he talked about, I think, is at least 5 miles away, if not further. And again, what we're looking for is we don't want to open a package store where people are coming in. We just want to be able to supplement the money we're making so we can pay the lease and keep the place running.
Right.
Comments? no, not this time. Is there any other public comments?
Anybody else like to speak?
Yeah, I'm here to support him.
Okay.
So, and
what's your name?
Since they opened the shop,
I've been. Tell me your name, sir.
I'm sorry. My name is Hamdi. I own the tailor shop in Greenfield.
Oh, okay.
I live in South Deerfield here.
Sure.
So, it's very easy for us to shopping from the gas or other stuff. And there's another convenience store that sometimes they close. You cannot find the owner there.
Right.
But these guys are very friendly, amazingly friendly. And I think they're doing a really good job. So we are so happy, me and my family, my friends. So we support him. I am here to support him.
Thank you.
Thank you. I have to say, I came here when they bought the property to look at it to see the shape it was in. I came back a few months ago. Not only was I impressed with the property, but I can't believe how many friends he's made since he's in town.
Yes. Really. That's good. What's that? Yeah, do we have any other public comment? Anybody else wish to speak on the permit? Then I will move to close the meeting, or close the hearing. Make a motion to close the hearing.
I second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Yeah.
Now we will discuss.
Do you have anything you want to say about it?
No, I mean, I understand the concerns, but I think, you know, with the possibility of Savage's closing, know you, I can't deny somebody an opportunity to make a living because of something that may happen on somebody else's, you know, because of a criminal.
Right.
And I know that they've done a good job of lighting the area, putting in security. They have never been cited for selling to a minor. So I would, at this point, I would be in favor of it. And but, you know, obviously keep an eye on it. If we have an issue at the school or if we have any issues in town,
yep.
You know, as with any place
sure.
that sells. I'm pleased that it's not a full liquor yep. place, you know, if it's just beer and wine.
And I appreciate the neighbors' comments, too.
Yeah.
I mean, some of the issues are related, some of them aren't. And I think that, you know, between our police department and, you know, the owners being, you know, diligent about selling to minors is a very important thing. I know our community has lost young people to that type of situation in the past. And, you know, this board would take selling to minors extremely serious. Mm. You know, I can't make it a requirement. It's just maybe a personal request that you make a policy to any of your employees that let them know in advance if they should sell to a minor that they, you know, could be fired and or fined as well as the owner. So, but with that being said, I don't have any problems approving the license.
So would we make a motion to, okay. So I'll make a motion to approve the Section 15 malt and wine license for Zafar Kiani, on behalf of the Deerfield Convenience Store LLC at 513 Greenfield Road in South Deerfield, Mass.
I'll second the motion.
Any more discussion?
Nope, good.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So be.
We can't Thank hear you.
You.
Can you use the microphones? Nobody can hear it. It's like very mumbled. Oh,
I will do a better job of that.
Is it
I know
on?
That's been, is it on? It seemed louder before.
Is this louder? Can you hear me now, or?
It's okay. It's hard. I think it's hard when you talk away from.
I'm sorry.
We'll do a better job of that.
Hey, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Somebody must have turned up some volume.
There you go.
You got it.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Is the library here to present? I don't see Sarah.
Not yet.
Okay.
They are expected at 7.
Oh, at 7.
They should
okay,
be here
great.
5 minutes from now.
So we can have
did you get all of the things for the
I did. Let me just make sure I did all that. There was a ton in here. I just wanted to make sure there were multiple signatures. But so this one was done. That one was done.
Yes.
So we are done.
You're all
yes,
set.
We're all set.
Yes. Thank congratulations
you.
And good luck to you.
Thank
you. Thank you very much. You. Have a good night. Nope, there's one more here.
I don't know if they need to be in any order, but
yeah. Okay. And then you'll have an application assigned later for license. That was just a signatures
okay.
and
yes.
support. You want while we're on the liquor license, do you want to? Do the one day application
sure.
for Yankee Candle. Just see if I can find that. So we will see discussion items. One day liquor license for Yankee Candle. Doug, do we have something to sign or do we just approve that?
That
or
is just
discussion?
That's something to approve and then take care of processing the paperwork.
Okay.
This, of course, is. It's a non-public event. It's a private event to be held on September 20th and 21st, I believe the dates are. It will be held at the grounds of Yankee Candle, in South Deerfield from about 6 in the evening to about 10 in the evening. The activities will take place south of the main retail building, so it won't be on the north side of the property. It won't be near Elm Street or Elm Circle. And the servers will likely be hired from the staff of Chandler's.
Okay.
So they will already be tips trained and certified. My understanding from Molly McMunn is also that there will be a limit of 2 beverages for any given person.
Okay.
They'll receive 2 tickets, and that's the only way they would be able to be served.
Yep.
So they are taking good care to take precautions and make sure that the event is successful but also safe.
Okay.
And I would certainly encourage support of the
event. I would make go ahead.
I don't have any problem with it. Do you?
No.
Okay.
I don't
either. I make a motion that we approve the 2 separate 1-day beer and wine licenses for Yankee Candle.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
It's done.
I'm done. All right.
And then let's see. We've got that done. We can do the warrants after. So we have appointments to the police department?
You actually have several appointments. I didn't know if you wanted to take them, you handle them all together while we're waiting for the library. You have...
You're there.
Is it just you?
Yeah, Sharon's here.
Oh, great. Well, come on up.
You're slow tonight.
Come on up. Good to see you.
Well, there was a big crowd before us. We have lots of vacations going on.
Oh, yes.
So we don't need a loud crowd to give the updates.
Great.
We wanted to approach you to give you some updates of where we are with the building project because things have been moving along. The Board of Trustees have been very busy. And as of September 1st, we have contracted the August fundraising strategies with Ellen Lukes as the principal to head up the fundraising campaign for the building project. We began our investigation of potential fundraisers last fall, and throughout the winter we solicited interest by different fundraisers, and the entire board interviewed all of those candidates. We narrowed that down to 2, and then we made our selection. Ellen is from Sunderland, and she's has a great deal of knowledge of the local towns, and mm-hmm. we think that she will, you know, be able to really do a great job. Some of the first work that the committee will be doing is really forming the fundraising committee, Capital King Committee, and right now that is composed of 4 board members of the library, and then we will be soliciting 6 to 8 people from the community at large to join in with us. Then we will be developing what that actual campaign amount would be that we feel would be something that's reasonable, and she would be able to do that through her knowledge and assessments of the communities at large, of other campaigns that are going on, so that, you know, we have a campaign that can be successful, but
yeah.
also will complement what we will need for the building project. The building project will be submitting its final report in October to the Mass Commission of Libraries. And then there will be multiple meetings across the state that Sarah, myself, the OPM will be attending, that will be about the application process, which will be due the end of January for the next phase of the project. So we're very excited to be at this juncture, and we wanted to make sure that we kept you abreast of that.
Great.
The other thing that we just wanted to give an update about was the library's 100th anniversary, and I had a bunch of dates that we have. So on November 5th, we will be having the rededication of the library, and so we're looking to develop a logo to promote that. There'll be invitations going out to the community at large and to different town officials, state officials to be there. So we hope that you'll be able
to
put
there.
It on your calendars.
Yeah.
And then throughout the year, there will be a variety of approximately 8 to 10 events that we'll be hosting. They will include having antique appraisals, book discussion groups, presentations and art display using the local schools and Bement School, a summer ice cream social that we're hoping the Women's Club will join us with. So we're wanting to do a lot of different kinds of things that will put the library front and present for the community at large.
Yeah.
And then in September 2017, we're hoping to have a big community dinner to have the final end of the project. So
great.
So did you have anything else you wanted to share,
Sharon? No, I think you pretty much covered it.
Yeah.
So we're very excited where the library is, and we'll be ready to start kicking that off. The other thing we wanted to just make sure, we had not heard any word back about the things that had, when we were here before, that we had asked for legal counsel's review, and we didn't know if there was any updates on those items.
There's not at this point. Okay. Legal counsel has been actually very busy working on sale of real estate for the town.
Sure.
And they have not had an opportunity as of yet to do the research on that particular deed. Okay. And determine a path forward.
We appreciate that, but we also don't want to lose sight of that.
Absolutely.
It would be instrumental. Absolutely. For all of us.
So. Yeah.
Didn't know. Yeah. If you, either of you, had any questions on the project of where we are.
Well, the only thing that I'd like to say is that if you've been paying attention at all what's been going on in town over the last couple of years, seems Deerfield, in my opinion, has fallen victim to a lot of different engineers, OPMs, and things of that sort. And I don't want to use the word warn, but I'd like to make your building committee aware of difficulties that they could be facing and inadvertently expose the town to. You know, we're most recently with the school elementary roof, you know, our town has spent nearly $500,000 to push paper around from week to week. And, you know, it's just, you know, the majority of people in this community aren't that wealthy. And if you think about the dollars that we've spent just to push paperwork is unconscionable. And if there's anything that your committee can get involved with or scrutinize, or even if you had to seek other help, you know, please be aware of this type of, I guess, behavior, or if maybe it's just generally how they do things. But I know that you know, the people that we're working with currently on the school roof have put the community in a hard place, you know, and it just have been taken advantage of the community, I feel. And I, after going through or witnessing what we went through at the highway garage and now at the school roof, I certainly wouldn't want to have to go through that again with the library.
Nor would we.
So, you know, and it, sometimes it's hard because if you're sitting there listening to someone making a presentation and it's everything you want to hear, it's very easy to sit back and say, oh, that's great, that's wonderful, it's all okay. But sometimes the devil's in detail, and when you get down to the nitty-gritty and you start reading, you know, what exactly is entailed, and you start finding out, well, now you've got to spend $10,000 for these people to come here and $20,000 to go over and do this. It's like, wow, you know, you think about all the things that you could do now with $10,000 and $20,000, and yet to be just shoveling that money here and there to see this project through. You know, so all I can say is anything, any involvement that your committee can, please don't just sit back and let somebody say, oh, this is what we can do for you. You
know? Well, and I think that that's one of the things that is very special about this project. Really, the Mass Board of Library Commissioners is involved from start to finish, and you know, they have professionals that they've worked with many, many projects over time, so there's track records on, you know, the different levels of people, the different reviews of the project. So it's our internal review, and then, you know, the involvement of the town that we have, but we also have the Mass Board of Library Commissioners, and they're very strict about, you know, what they want to be able to happen in the project, and, you know, when they're, if they're putting up 50% of that money, we can be assured that, you know, that they're going to, you know, have a lot of oversight, and I think that's one of the things that over the past 2.5 years that I've heard of all the meetings that they schedule to make sure that everybody is educated along the way for all the different components that have to happen, and through the application processes, through the reports that have to be submitted and things like that. So, but you're right, we will.
And with that note, I mean, the Mass School Building Authority, you would think would be the same type of organization. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when we kind of are in a little jam, they're very easy to sit back and say, well, we'll see how you guys handle it, and, you know, we'll, you know. And it's just the wrong, it's the wrong approach, you know. I don't want to say they don't care, but it would have been easy for them to step up and say to these people, hey, what are you doing? And there again, these people in Boston picked these people that we now have to pay. The town of Deerfield didn't get to do that. And that's, to me, a big problem, you know. And you can look at a laundry list of all the successful projects and stuff like that. But what my research went, sure, they complete a lot of projects, and everything does go along fine, as long as you keep paying the money. You know, and that's what the problem is. You know, so just...
Well, I think your words of caution are important, because as we move forward, you know, there will be, the Planning and Design Committee will conclude, and there will be another building committee, and, you know, the selection of members of that committee will be crucial to, have the expertise to understand and to be able to help make some of those decisions and review that.
That would be great.
And we'll definitely take that under consideration.
Great.
Okay, well, so
thank you so much for the update.
Didn't want to take up a lot of your time,
your
but we wanted to just keep you apprised,
I,
because come September 1, we'll be moving forward.
So. I dropped by a little flyer to Sarah the other day about, I think it was West Springfield had put up a new library as well, and they were, I was in a pizza joint, and they had this flyer that you could donate, or you could buy a brick.
Oh, yes.
You know, it's a fundraising thing where you could buy a brick and... So to have other ideas
about
fundraising.
Well, there's all kinds of ideas like that that, you know, need to be considered so that there can be community involvement.
Absolutely.
And those are the kinds of things that you want to do, because we want everybody to contribute, you know, what they can. If they can donate
a
dollar because that's what they can afford, you know, you have to have some mechanism to find a way to... you know, let them make that contribution and have it be valued for
have everybody
for the
be a part of it.
And then we're hoping that there'll be some other donors that will give more than that.
Yes.
So, great.
Thank you again.
Right.
Before you go away, you mentioned a name towards the beginning, head of your, I assume, the capital campaign?
Yes, it's Ellen Lukes, L-E-U-K-S. She's the principal. It's August Fundraising Strategies.
August Fundraising
strategies.
Strategies. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
You.
Have a great night. It's
we'll
great
be
to
back
see
to
you.
See you soon.
Yeah. let's see. So then we can move on to our police department appointments. As you were saying, Doug, we've got a couple.
Yeah, you do have a couple of different appointments for the police department, and in your packet is the request from the chief of police. This is for two full-time appointments, one to replace one officer who recently resigned, another to replace an officer that I think resigned some time back. These two full-time appointments will bring the police department back up to a full staffing. You also have an appointment of a part-time officer of Mr. Brent Griffin, who recently resigned. He would like to stay on in a part-time capacity, and the police chief has concurred and is recommending him be appointed part-time. Each of these individuals are being appointed as both police officers and assistant animal control officers, which is, I guess, a legal appointment, which allows them to assist as needed.
Okay.
Is it proper for us to do it individually or together?
If you'd like to do it individually, that's fine. If you'd like to do it together and just get it done, that's fine, too. You could just appoint the three people mentioned as presented or as requested.
Do it that way?
Sure.
Right. I make a motion that we appoint the three individuals recommended by Chief Pachurik.
And let's see. So that would be to appoint Mr. Brent Griffin as part-time officer in animal control, and Tyler Hersom as a full-time.
Jacob
Eugen. So I second that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
And I actually have these three forms. If you would please sign on either of the any of the three lines there on each of the forms.
Hi.
Just a quick question. How come when you appointed someone to the administrative assistant for the town clerk's office, you added the step and all the other information, and like this appointment you didn't? Is there a reason for that?
You mean labeled out the, well, the chief made a recommendation, has the amounts on here. I mean,
Is it on the steps, or are they on follow a different?
I think, yeah, they're on a different pay structure. Yep, exactly. Yep, they're.
The police, full-time police officers are paid under the structure as approved by the collective bargaining agreement. And that schedule operates in the same way as the general government schedule. Each of the two full-time officers were appointed at grade one, step one.
Well, I just didn't know why you didn't enter it into your vote, so it's
sure.
It's more information, something for the chief to go by or whatever.
Well, I think they're, like Doug said, their contract dictates what it is that they get, so that's probably the reason.
So who are the two full-time officers?
So we've got Jacob Eugen and
Tyler Urson. And they've both been part-time, I believe, right?
They've worked part-time in the office, or in the department. They've both been through the academy, or will have finished the academy fairly soon, and that's why they're being appointed at grade one, step one. There's a different rate for even full-time officers who have not completed academy training. So these are qualified young men who should be good additions to the force.
And did include that one part-time?
Correct. Brent Griffin actually is the part-time person, appointed at a lower rate.
Yep.
And the appointment papers have their rates and everything else as necessary. Great. That's great. Thank you.
Sure. And then we have to appoint a representative to the Upper Pioneer Valley Veterans District. It's a one-year appointment, and we're appointing Joanne Carney. She's agreed to continue as the representative for the Upper Pioneer Valley District and to continue attending the monthly meetings.
Correct. And I've been in communication with Joanne. She is pleased to do it, and she said she is very would be pleased and humbled to represent our veterans.
Wonderful.
On behalf of the town of Deerfield.
She's a great representative.
In reviewing the materials that I received from the Upper Pioneer Valley.
We can't hear you.
I'm sorry.
Joanne Carney. No.
Yep, from Sherman Drive.
Before my
yep.
volume was much louder, and it's not louder
anymore. It's fine. It's just that when you talk away from the microphone and you talk, it's just very mumbled. So
I've never been accused of being quiet before, and I appreciate you doing
it. used to frustrate me as well.
You are quiet.
I apologize.
I turned my hearing aids all the way up to the top.
I'm sorry. I will speak up.
Can we ask who the new clerk is in the office that we haven't met yet?
The new assistant town clerk? That is a woman, and I murder her last name each time I say it. It's Lisa Cicci, or Cicia, C-I-C-I-A, and she started just this week.
Okay, thank you.
She's trial by fire this week.
I've never met her myself.
The one thing I wanted to mention about the Upper Pioneer Valley Veterans District is that there is an opportunity for the town to appoint an alternate to this as well, which we don't have a name for a person. To that alternate position, but if there's somebody out there, speaking to the viewers and everybody here, if there's somebody out there who would like to be appointed, I would encourage them to get in touch with any select board member or with the administrator's office, and they can serve in that capacity.
Great.
Well, I make a motion that we appoint Joanne Carney to the Veterans District.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Do we have any public comment tonight?
That's fine.
Yay! Come on up.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think when I started coming to the meetings, one of my main concerns was the Oxford Pickle site. I see they've made an attempt to clean it up, but I still see them hauling trees in and everything else. And the other thing, as I listened, I think I was here at the meeting that Kip questioned the metal recycling at the landfill. And I see when they cleaned up that lot, they had a metal recycling truck there instead of using their own town dump truck. And I think I have a real problem with that because I sat here and listened to Carolyn say that the town had to use their trucks and everything else. And now I, you know, walking through the lot, seeing a metal recycling truck there. And I know that was Kip's concern, that why isn't the town getting the money for it? You're paying for the hauling, and they may get a percentage, I don't know, but you'd think they would get more if they had done it themselves. And I guess my other concern about that is that, is it possible to delineate how much the town can dump on that site and how far they can go? Because we have a whole landfill, and when you see them hauling the trees they took down on Sugarloaf Street back into that site instead of putting them on a truck and taking them to the landfill, it's, I don't know, to me seems counterproductive. And it just seems like they're keep encroaching on that other space.
I don't know what to say. I wasn't aware that they were hauling trees there, but I can definitely speak to Kevin about that. The only thing that I knew that was kept there was the bricks and broken pieces of concrete and asphalt that they were going to recycle and use for other things. I don't know why the trees were dumped there instead of at the landfill. And I don't even really know if at the landfill we have a stump dump or a tree dump.
There are three kinds of, and you, I'm speaking to you, and I apologize if it sounds like I'm speaking down. There are three types of materials you get when you take down a tree. One is the brush. One is the actual wood, the heart of the tree, and the other would be the stump. Brush is usually chipped and hauled away if a tree is taken down. The stumps would be put into a truck and hauled up to the transfer station. At the very back of the property, there is still a stump dump that is used by the town. And the other material would be wood that could be used for firewood. It is very, I can't speak to it. I didn't see it, but I would be willing to put down a dollar stating that that was probably the bulk of the material brought back to the lot. Oftentimes, there are people who will use that firewood, whether it's town residents or others. And in some cases, the highway department has actually sold that and made a little bit of money.
But so I still guess the question is, why can't they just haul it to the landfill? Do you think they would? They just keep encroaching on the space and making it look messier and messier. It just seems like they have this whole huge lot, and it's like
it's a highway yard.
It's
a highway yard. It's gonna
It's not a highway yard. Go through by a lot of highway yards, and you don't find all that debris on them. I'm sorry. And you know, I saw them bringing the stuff, but I've also been to the landfill when I've seen the wood there, and wood split and ready for people to take. And you know, at some point it has to be cut up. Somebody's not going to drive in. Not many people have a truck that can haul away a 10 or 12 foot log, you know.
So who would
20, 30 inches in diameter?
Who would be splitting the wood?
I don't know. Doug is saying, that somebody could do it from the landfill, but who would be splitting it? I don't know. Who could haul it away? I don't know. But
what we can do is speak with Kevin and find out the story about the materials that were being stored there. I would be also willing to bet that if a tree is being taken down in Old Deerfield, then the materials are being hauled to the transfer station. If the materials are being taken down in South Deerfield, they're probably hauled to the lot there just to save on fuel. And in particular,
but the price of fuel.
In any given tree that gets taken down, you may have anywhere from 2 to 6 loads of material.
I watched it, Doug. I saw the payloader bring it one by one to the.
And that was probably the tree that was taken down on Lower Sugarloaf Street, which had a base diameter of about 4.5 feet. So that was probably
My question is, what's going to happen to it there? Is it really going to be cut up and by the town?
Why don't we speak with Kevin and we'll get some answers?
I'll talk with Kevin. I mean, I didn't see any of this, but you know, just from picking apart different pieces, if the tree was that big, maybe it wasn't put into a truck at first. Maybe it was just picked up by the loader.
I saw it hauled there.
It was hauled there in a loader.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So
the reason
obviously
they hauled it on the loader was because they couldn't get they would have had to take the tailgate off the truck to get it out of the truck.
Right.
Okay.
And that would require somebody over there with a loader, and there's only so many people.
I know, but every time I hear that, things get done, but after the fact. And like I said, and why was the metal not hauled away by the town?
I don't.
Didn't we sign a contract with what truck was it? I mean, I think we signed a contract with
I don't know.
They
I just know.
Metal,
in terms of the scrap materials that were taken away, it was two, I think, at least 30, if not 40-yard dumpsters that were placed there. That would have represented four or five truckloads, if it's all just metal, four or five truckloads up to Kramer's and Greenfield.
But did we? Do you know if we benefited from the scrap metal?
I have no
or
idea.
Did we just pay to get it hauled away?
I don't know.
Price of scrap metal now is in the cellar.
Yeah,
oh, it is.
Not getting much.
It is, but you know, it's still. I mean, if you get $50 for a truckload, it beats paying somebody $300 to truck it away. I mean, but I don't know, but I can talk to Kevin about that. But it seems to me like, you know, that this tree might have been so large that it was just difficult to put into a truck. So they used a big loader and brought it to the yard, and they're going to cut it up or dispose of it.
But so, I guess my question, who's responsible for cutting it up? They send people, like I said, I've seen it at the landfill.
Yeah.
Well, they might be cutting it up there and then sand it up to the landfill.
Might. I mean, I don't even know. If the tree was that large, probably the town hired somebody to cut it down. And
yes,
then to save money with the tree service, the town hauled it away. And it was easier for them just to haul it over to the garage and then cut it up. I'm going to assume that. You know, they might not cut it up into firewood. They just might cut it into smaller pieces when they have time. That then it could fit into a dump truck, you know, without dismantling the tailgate. And, you know, that's quite a job. Mm-hmm. So
I don't know.
Yeah.
It's not like I've had, you know,
yeah.
come from that kind of business.
Well,
where,
I'll look at it. You know, I will talk to Kevin about it and just, you know, try to make
but
sure
like
that
like I said,
it
so, but
start.
My other bigger concern is delineating how much more they can put on there. And... Well, you know, because it's like I said, it just keeps creeping, and I feel sorry for the neighbors who behind there
yeah.
have to have all this stuff being dumped in their backyard. Yeah. And like I said, it's a beautiful place to walk through.
Yeah.
And they did finally clean it up, which yeah. I appreciate. But yeah. it's still some of the things that you know
well,
that
you
were
know,
issues were at the time couldn't do, and then right. all of a sudden they got done.
Yeah.
Yeah. The way they couldn't be done before, let's put it that way. So,
well, you know, to a certain extent, what Doug is saying, it is true. I mean, it is it's town property, and I can see them, you know, taking the tree there to cut it up at a more convenient time for them. Now, that's not saying that it should stay there for a year, but, you know, I don't really know. I can't
right.
speak for Kevin, and I don't, you
well,
know,
that's
I don't
why
see
I can't either,
day,
so I'm why I'm
yeah.
coming here and,
well, we'll
you know,
I'll find
asking
out.
The
I'll
question
talk with them about it and see.
And then yeah. just the possibility of delineating a line
yeah.
as far as, you know, of what they can, how far they can go. And, you know, I just feel bad. It's this beautiful $6 million garage that we're going to pay for a long time. And to have it look like that, you know, around there and have them keep dumping constantly. And,
I understand.
But it's good to have the site cleaned up, so I did want to come back and say appreciate that and getting it cleaned up and hopefully.
Well, you never know from time to time. These little disasters constantly pop up. So, I mean, we only have six guys that work there. So, you know, I mean, it's.
Yeah, but it's been an easy summer, don't forget, and there hasn't been a lot of lawns to mow.
Well, I know. But I'm
just
sure
like the winter, not a lot of snow to plow. So.
Yeah. Sharon, you have a question?
While you're talking about the wood, what happens to the wood when the town takes down town trees? Because I have seniors that still burn wood, and through the Dryad program, I have to buy the wood.
Well, I don't.
So that takes up some of our funds that we could use for fuel oil or whatever, if we could actually use some of the wood.
Well, I don't think that Kevin or any of us would have a problem, you know, letting anyone take the wood. I just don't know what kind of.
I know Kathy's talking about big pieces and
right.
stuff like that. They could handle that because
correct.
They're seniors.
Right.
But
if somebody's splitting or wanting
to donate
time. If
there was smaller pieces and we knew about it and we could get someone to transfer it to a home or whatever, that would help tremendously.
A good well, thought.
It's
just a thought when you're talking about the
yeah.
trees and where you put them and what do you do with the excess wood.
Yeah, and maybe if somebody donated some time to split, cut and split it, then transfer it over to your seniors, that may be a good use, if in fact it's not spoken for.
Probably the majority of the like the limbs and stuff, anything, I would say that 6 inches or smaller just gets chipped anyways. It's just so much faster to do that. And, you know, the time you spend to cut it all up and stuff, and that's why firewood is so expensive. It sure isn't the wood, it's the time that it takes to cut it all up. But, you know, I'll talk to Kevin about the trees.
Yeah, because we're already gearing up for that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
For the fuel oil and for the wood, sure. To see how much money we have that we can get out there for those projects.
Sure.
So it'd be good.
Yeah.
And
good
if
thought.
You can just get back to me and give me a heads up,
sure.
That'd be great.
All right.
Thank you.
I was talking with Kevin here earlier in the spring when those trees were coming down. They did a bunch of trees on Wapping Road. And he said his budget doesn't have enough money to take down the trees that need to be taken down.
That's true. That is true.
It was close to 80,000 short.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's a lot of wood out there. It's just no money for the manpower to get it down.
Well, Eversource took it down. And they left it on the side of the road, and a lot of people took it.
Yeah,
they cut it
into
sizable pieces.
That's what Kevin did on Wapping Road. That's what he's been doing in Old Deerfield.
Yeah.
On the back roads.
He's been cutting and leaving.
Yeah, but leaving usually that's been a town practice for years.
Is that right?
Broadly speaking, the Kevin's described his policy as this: if a tree comes down, if a tree is taken down or limbed in front of a house, the material is left there. The expectation is that the homeowner may want it, and they have sort of, it's an unofficial right of first refusal, mm-hmm. but after 2 or 3 days, it's either picked up by the highway staff or other people come along with the side of the road and pick it up. So
I know trees that have been taken down in front of our property, we've always told the town that we would haul it away, which we have always too, but that's been a town policy for years. But I do know there was a good-sized load of wood that was cut and split and left at the landfill.
Okay,
about
for people
a month
to
ago.
Take.
And I don't know where it came from.
Yeah.
I just happened to be there and noticed it, and it was gone. Quickly. So.
Well, we'll ask. It's a good question.
Any other question? When we bought the pickup last time, or whatever piece of equipment that was purchased by the town, did they dispose of the other piece?
I'm not sure which piece you're speaking of.
Well, you just awarded a bid a week ago or 2 weeks ago?
Yeah,
the bid was not awarded 2 weeks ago.
It wasn't.
It was.
I tried to find all the minutes online, and I couldn't find that.
Yeah.
But we did buy a tract recently, and there was an old tractor and a mower and a few other pieces of equipment that were, I guess, traded in.
Okay. And there's still the truck sitting at the landfill, so.
Yeah, they have. I don't think they've awarded
a
bid.
Landfill?
What truck?
That one's been there for a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
You mean a dump truck?
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, I don't know about that. Don't know.
Look at that one. But
you don't?
I don't go to the landfill. Dumpster.
All right. Let's see. So that was it for public comment? Anybody? Oh. Yeah, come on up. How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good.
I have two questions. My name is Bruce Hunter, and the first question relative to a contract that was just signed this evening, relative to sludge hauling.
Yes.
I missed the figures. It was 5 cents a gallon for liquid, and how much for dry?
I think it was a $350.
It was a 3.5% for the
solid waste. And then there was, I think,
solid
$350 for solid, I think.
I had 250 written down. I'm not sure.
I could be wrong.
Too many numbers for me to remember.
Too much money. That's what it was.
Well, the reason I ask is Kevin had sent me the last 6 months
yep.
of bills, and I was working some numbers for the sewer study committee for
right.
tomorrow's night meeting.
Yep.
And the 5 cents was already being charged, so that wasn't an increase.
It's transportation cost per gallon is 5.93 cents per gallon.
93, yep, that's what it was.
A disposal cost per dry ton of $350.
$350, that went up then.
And the contract states that there's a 3.5% administrative fee, not to exceed $6,000 per year.
So that fee
and
went up $100.
This does not
it was 250.
It was 250.
And this does not include any fuel surcharges.
If there are any, which there won't be.
This year, they're low, right?
I'm guessing there will be because of the distance.
No, it's because of the price.
I believe that's true.
Not distance, it's price.
It's price.
The other question I had was...
Fair enough, yes.
That increase is $100 on dry charge. Is it going to Cranston? Is that what we're sending?
Cranston, Rhode Island, yeah.
The only place local.
Okay. That was $250 last month.
Wow.
There you go.
The other question I had is, I believe at your meeting on August 10th, you had Mr. Gilmore in and discussed his property. Was that the meeting, August 10th?
Let me just take a look here. August 2nd?
August 2nd.
2nd.
And then again on the 17th.
And then, right, then he came back.
Back,
oh, wait,
give an update.
Let's see, the 10th? Yes, there was. The 10th, there was another.
The 10th, we were not allowed to speak?
That's true. Yes.
Okay. Well, I'd like to speak now, if I could.
Sure.
In the last 2 weeks since the 10th, the property has not changed. Condition of the property has not changed. I would like to have the Board of Selectmen at least do a timeline relative to the dumping that is, by our bylaw, is not allowed. And also, I believe that there's a use there that very well might not be allowable in a residential use.
What use is that?
Either repair of vehicles or equipment.
There shouldn't be anything going on the site at all relation to that.
All right. Well, there's equipment there that's parked waiting to be repaired or removed.
Is that the lift?
Yes. So I know he doesn't own the lift, so my guess is that he's going to repair it for somebody.
Yeah.
So those are the two issues that I have with the property, and the abutters have the similar issues, and there's still, there was an attempt early on the first week in August to remove some of the stump material and the dumpsters, and that did occur. But the majority of the stump material, and there's a couple of abandoned trailers, there's some, like the lift, and other trailers full of repair equipment are still on the site. Now, we'd just like for the selectmen to come up with a timeline and that the entire property would be brought back to a residential use. It was my concern, too, that maybe the building that was built did not have a building permit.
Yeah, I'd have to ask Richard on that. I don't know if you know. Do you know? That was before.
I don't know.
It was early.
So those are the only two comments that I have.
Is it not allowable to have stumps? I just not
no.
Curious.
There's a bylaw under dumping that doesn't allow you to dump.
If the material comes from off-site, it is not permitted to be dumped on the property.
On your property.
It's Mr. Gilmore's contention that the pile of stumps that is on the property came from the property. And according to Mr. Kalaszewski, there is no, that does not violate any bylaw or any regulation.
But,
and as a matter of fact, if he were to bury it, that would
understood.
Violate a regulation. So.
Okay, so I don't know why he removed part of it then. So I just, since I didn't have a chance to speak on the 10th, and the residents also wanted to speak, but I thought they were coming back with a two-week update.
Well,
And that would have been 2 weeks from the 10th, which would have been tonight. And I don't see any change in those 2 weeks to the property. If that's what the town is accepting as the existing proposed use, we need to know that.
All I can do is speak for myself. If you go back to the second, we asked Mr. Gilmore to do certain things, and during that week, some things had changed, some things had improved.
Yes.
Didn't make it right, but had made better. The Gilmores requested to come in and speak to the board on what they were going to do. Carolyn decided that it would be best that the public not speak and just let's take in the, what the Gilmores had to say. And since they were going in that direction of making it better, to give them the chance to see where they were going to go with it. And, you know, I agree with you. I haven't seen any change. There's a lot of things in our bylaws that, to me, are a little confusing. I've reached out to our town council. I know that Doug has reached out to our town council. We have gotten different opinions. There are different things that we can do. Things get complicated, too. One of the things that has recently been complicated is that, you know, you can't have this type of construction equipment. Well, I do know that the Gilmores applied for a building permit to re-roof the building. So now, in a way, does that justify the aerial lift to use as for re-roofing? You know, if it does, then now that, you know, so there's a lot. There's a lot that goes on, and so, you know, so one of the things that I did read, and I do know that, and I keep pushing on to everybody, and you could do this too, is to write a letter complaining to the building inspector, you know, of this violation. That in itself holds a lot of weight. It might not seem much, but people can come and complain, and yes, we do listen, but by what the statute says, it's these written complaints that really hold a lot of weight.
The building inspector.
To the building inspector.
He has the power.
And he's the one that, you know, we have to instruct to do it.
Right, that's what I would like.
It was like with the running of the diesels. You know, they can call the Board of Selectmen, but because of that statute, they have to notify the police department, and the police department makes a log and stuff like that, and they can actually go there and find them $100 if that vehicle is running. And, you know, if it's within a reason, and I don't even know what reasonable is, but if it happens 3 days later, then they can say that's a second violation and charge them $300 and $300 for every one. But if the people around there don't do this, you know, they can come say, well, it ran six times last month and nobody did anything. Unless the police are notified, you know, I know it's a pain in the butt, but, you know, you have to do it the right way. And
okay. Well, thank you very much. I will write a letter to the building inspector, but I do not believe that in the bylaw relative to dumping, it allows you to dump on your own property material that should be at the landfill.
Okay. And you're right. There's a lot of the bylaws that get what gets more tricky is how do you enforce the bylaws? You know,
understood.
You know, the town can take individuals to court, spend a lot of money, and they can make statements in court. The judge can give them more time. Our bylaws do allow for fining in certain circumstances, but they have to meet certain requirements. And, you know, trying to weed between all of the stuff is...
So it might be best for the residents, the abutters, to take them to court to make sure the town does what needs to be done.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll advise about that.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
All right,
thanks,
Bruce.
Thank you. Let's see. I did have a couple of comments too. What else do we got here?
There's a couple of pieces of other business.
Okay.
But I don't. Did I even include us? I'm not sure if we included a comments of select board on there. So you can make comments whenever you want.
I think I'll make a couple of comments. Unless you want to go first. Do you have any? You got some stuff to work on.
No, you go first.
Okay, so I just a couple of things. The other day, it was Wednesday, we had a meeting on the mosquito control. Carolyn and people from the state and the Department of Public Health were here, and we're discussing, you know, different programs the states are doing. And they were discussing with us why we're going private. We explained cost. And so it was a great meeting, and there were going to be follow-up meetings involved in it. We're trying to come up with a way to have the state help, but it's got to be affordable and to get a baseline of what's going on. So I'd gotten word that from VDCI, who is our mosquito tester right now, that there have been no positive test for Triple E or West Nile virus with dry weather. I know we had a little bit of rain recently, so next week the trapping count may be up, but right now it's been low because of that. But just if everybody would patrol the yards, dump the water, normal stuff Carolyn says every week, you know, wear deep and protectant. And then the state is still testing for free. So our trappings are getting tested for free right now, which is really good. And then let's see, another item I wanted to discuss, and I've been getting a ton of complaints about, is the propane cannons that farmers are using. So they have quieted in my area last week, or this week for sure. It's been, I don't think I've heard them. So I know it has to do with how much, you know, when the sweet corn's ready. I know they do it like 3 days before it's ready, because that's when the birds can come in. And it was unbelievably loud, and one night all night long. So, and I think that was an error by the farmer. They didn't mean to run them all night. So it's a delicate balance, because they've got to protect their crops, and we all live in a farming community. So you know, with the sweet smell of manure in the spring, this is one of the things we have to get used to. But there has to be some sort of balance, because you know, if we have veterans here with PTSD and they're hearing that constantly all night long, the dogs are going crazy. It gets really oppressive, and every 4 minutes, three or four of them go off, and it's just a constant drone of a howitzer going off in your neighborhood. It's really, really unsettling for a lot of people. But I want to just thank them that it quieted down. But there may be other areas in town where it hasn't quieted down just because of the planting schedule. So I was going to ask if we could just have an education by the Ag Committee, mm-hmm. if they would come and just tell us, you know, educate the public on what it is, and us on what it is they do, what the schedule is, what the decibel level is, what the plan is, so people can kind of be aware, mm-hmm. of what's happening, when it happens, and mm-hmm. Any way that they can, you know, alleviate some of it. So
I'd like to mention at this point that I've also received a couple of telephone calls from residents expressing their concerns about the use of these propane-fueled cannons. To that end, I reached out to peers in other towns in Western Mass, and I was advised by Ray Purrington to reach out to a gentleman named, it's Steve Westover, I believe. He's got a 665 number, so I think he's somewhat local, but he worked either for a municipality or for the state on the agricultural side of things, and I asked for some advice in regard to them. I've also reached out to Steve Taylor, who's the chair of the Agricultural Committee, and suggested that maybe there might be a joint meeting on either September 7th or September 21st to start that conversation. I finally reached out to, again, my peers in other towns to see if any towns had bylaws that regulate these. I received absolutely no responses whatsoever, which implies that no one knows of any, or there are no bylaws in force anywhere. So,
yeah. So there was one of the articles that was forwarded to me in you know, in complaint of the things, said that, you know, some states are becoming successful. Like Virginia had enacted a law that permits local jurisdictions to silence loud noises on the farms, that kind of thing. But we don't. Again, that we have to find a balance. The farmers need to farm, and they need to protect their investment. It's been a hard year for farmers with lack of rain, lack of hay, lack of, you know, the corn, all that stuff. So I know that they're protecting everything they can. It's a very hard living. So, but if they can just educate the public, and we could find some sort of happy medium, or at least we'd know when it happened, when, and at what decibel level does it work well and not work well, just to try and be, I know they are respectful of their neighbors, but just it's been really tough the last couple of weeks. But anyways, so that was it. If we could just get educated and
sure.
and learn.
Well, it would be nice to hear from some of the farmers that use them to see exactly how successful it really is. I mean, you know, I don't really consider myself a full-fledged farmer, but I go out in my back 20 and I mow hay, and I can get within 10 feet of, you know, coy dogs, fox, all kinds of turkey vultures and everything, and the noise doesn't seem to bother them. When you first, when the something happens, they flinch, but the noise doesn't seem to bother them. I don't know. I'm not saying that these don't work, but
right, they may, and they may have a diminishing effect over so many months, but or weeks.
You know, and a lot of times animals, they get kind of used to that. In another scenario where, you know, I have a problem with seagulls on a boat, and I have things that spin and, you know, make noise, sprinkle, you know, that seagull will sit on a quarter inch on the very edge, and that sweep will go right by his tail, and he knows it, and just he knows where he's not going to get hit, you know. And so, you
sure,
know, animals are kind of smart, you know.
I can reach out to some of our local farmers and find out if they'd be interested in attending that meeting.
Just to educate us and let us know.
Yeah,
and
to talk about the effectiveness of these tools as well.
Sure. That'd be great.
Yeah.
Let's see, I'm trying to think if I have anything else. I think that was it.
I see here that there's a request, and I talked with Kevin about this. He's looking for money to, do a study to see if they get rid of that pump station at the end of Captain Lathrop. Today I went and I spoke to some...
What's it, a lift station?
Yeah, there's a pump station.
A lift
because when they put in Captain Lathrop, the sewer was so low, they couldn't put it into the sewer on North Main Street. So there's a pump station. You know, my first thought is, well, you know, a lot of these guys were pretty clever people. If they could have done it that way in the beginning, they would have. But I reached out to some longtime residents of the town to find out exactly what it was. And I actually spoke with an old plumber who plumbed the house that's right on the corner. And it's a substantial way down there. Captain Lathrop takes a dip, and right there. I don't know if the sewer pipe goes under the brook or above it, but there's an issue there. But I would, instead of spending that money to do a study, I would rather just open the catch basins and just take a transit and shoot some elevations to find out what the difference in grade is. Instead of spending thousands of dollars, have somebody tell us, no, you can't do it,
Makes sense.
But we can, I'll talk with Kevin more about that as well.
Okay.
Okay.
So are you going to take no action on that?
Yeah, let's take no action on that right now.
Okay. And then there's an adopt, buy, recycle policy?
There is. Since 1990... I think the town has had a buy recycled policy in force, 93, 95, something like that. And it has not been updated since then. I compared the policy that you've got in your packet with the policy that has been in force, and they're virtually identical. I think somebody just wordsmithed it a little bit. This is something which enables the Franklin County Solid Waste District to apply for and receive certain grant monies. And each year the town reaffirms the policy and reminds department heads that they should be looking for ways to purchase materials that are recycled or at least partially contain recycled content. We do so in town hall by buying paper goods with recycled content as much as possible. And even our photocopier paper is 20 or 30% recycled at least, if not 50. The Solid Waste District has requested that the buy recycled policy be once again endorsed and approved, adopted by the board, and we will use that as we move forward with our work with that organization.
I'm trying to find that. I
can't find it.
It might be very close to the end.
And it's
a contract with the bakery.
It is page 57.
Oh, they're numbered. 57. Oh, thank you. Okay.
I think the change between the current policy and this proposed policy is the part in section one in italics that says that the decision not to procure recycled content paper products shall be based solely on a determination that the items are not available within a reasonable time period, or that items fail to meet reasonable performance standards, or are only available at an unreasonable price. We found that we actually can buy recycled or 40 or 50% content recycled paper for our copiers from one vendor at a much lower cost than we could get
new content paper from others. We found a good vendor that provides us with a very good price. So in that case, it's a no-brainer. Buying recycled works for us. I've received also comments from both the wastewater treatment department as well as the library, and both of those have active recycling policies in place, not only for the use of recycled content material, but also for the recycling of materials. Yeah, exactly. So.
Since this is pretty similar to what we had, are you looking for us to accept this new version of it? Or?
Correct.
Okay.
And these state contracts are obviously priced.
State contracts are tricky. Sometimes the state contracts give us a slightly better price on materials that we're buying, whether it's salt or copy paper, regardless. Sometimes state contracts do not provide any financial advantage, and we can buy locally from local vendors for a lower price. So when we look at the state contracts, we certainly, like in the example of copy paper, again, I think the current vendor that we use is on the state contract, and that's why we're buying from that vendor. In this case, it's great. The paper is cheaper, significantly cheaper, and the service is excellent. In other cases, state contracts don't provide a fiscal advantage.
Okay.
And so, we fall under that.
Wherever feasible is the...
Right, exactly. Yeah. Okay. Exactly. So.
Well, see any problem with that? We need to make a motion on that?
If you would. Okay.
Make a motion to follow the recycled product purchasing policy.
I'll second it.
Dated, given this 24th day of August 2016. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Do you have a separate copy you want us to sign?
I was looking, and I don't think I do, but if it's okay with you, I'll use the signature stamps. And
that's
we'll
fine.
Yep,
right out
that's
here.
Fine.
Yep.
Great, thank you. Done.
We're doing a good job of staying on time today, huh?
Carolyn will need to sign that. There's that. And I think, I'm trying to think if there's anything else that I have on my plate. I don't know if you have anything on your plate.
I have a letter on your plate. I don't know if you, let's see.
There are a couple of letters of comment that were put into the packet, yes. Scrolling down towards the end.
Did you happen to put in that letter of resignation from the Finance Committee? Or?
I don't think it made its way into the packet. I think it's, I think you might have either gotten an email. I literally just got it a little bit later.
Okay.
Either early afternoon.
Do you want to just wait
till
next meeting to deal with it, or do you want us to?
The letter of resignation from the Finance Committee?
Yeah.
Actually, it was just included for your information.
Okay.
Board of Selectmen do not act on Finance Committee appointments.
Oh, right.
Okay.
That would be
the letter went to Dan Graves.
Okay.
Ralph Healy submitted his resignation effective August 31st.
Yep.
And so I'm sure the town moderator will be looking for another person to fill that chair. Ralph Healy.
Ralph Healy? And we also, let's see, we have other openings, right, on boards. Personnel?
There are a number of openings on a variety of boards. I think I counted a total of about 18 separate positions between the Personnel Committee, the Finance Committee, and a number of other positions. Those are updated and on the town's website. It's in the News and Announcements page. And if anybody would like to find out what positions are open, I encourage you to look there.
Please.
If anybody's interested in filling any of those positions, they can reach out to the administrator's office. Express their interest, and either I'll forward the request to you, to the board, or I will forward it to the right appointing authority.
Do you have a question, please?
Yes, I had one additional question.
Sure.
The MassWorks application, The due dates start tomorrow. Is that going to be submitted for the Headworks project?
The due date for the letters of support was tomorrow. I have letters of support from all of our surrounding municipalities, from several of the nonprofits, the local private schools. I have letters of support from the town of Greenfield, one from our state representative, Steve Kulik, one from our state senator, Stan Rosenberg, and a number of letters from some of the companies local to the town. Those are all going to be forwarded first thing in the morning in electronic form to Weston and Sampson, will be included with the grant. And the 20, is it Thursday or Friday? I think it's Friday is the date when applications can first be submitted for MassWorks grants. So we will have ours completed and ready to submit on day one.
Okay, so it is.
Yep, absolutely.
It's thank you. Ahead.
Thank you.
You do have a letter in your packet from a resident who actually was complimentary of the website, and
yes.
I want to thank that resident. I think she knows who she is, resident from up on Mountain Road. It's really great to get positive feedback, and we appreciate it. I included the email that Trevor forwarded in regard to, that was a comments related to 72 Mill Village Road.
Yep.
That's in your packet. You have the letter of resignation from Kat Dolan, who served as the temporary administrative clerk in the administrator's office.
Yep.
And you have my letter in there as well.
We do.
So there's that. And we do have a need for an executive session to discuss purchase and or transfer of real estate.
Okay. Well, I will make a...
I mean, I don't mean to rush you into that.
No, but I was. Well, do you have anything you want to talk about before school roof or anything like that? You're in good shape.
No, I just an update for the community that the school roof is pretty much 95% done. They will be substantially completed on time. It will not interrupt the opening of school. You know, there's a little bit of work to do on the grounds, but not that much. No, it doesn't appear to be any problems going forward.
Great. So. It looks really good.
Yeah. Looks yeah, really the contractor did a very good job, and I think all in all, it came out well.
Great.
So. Yep.
Sounds good. Let's see. Well, make a motion to enter into executive session. Second here.
Close the.
Discuss strategy in relation to the sale or transfer of real estate.
Yes. Yes. So I make a motion to enter an executive session to discuss in relation to the sale or transfer of real estate. I'm McDaniel.
I, Henry Camosa.
Will you be coming out to do anything other than to adjourn?
We will be coming out only to adjourn.
Very good.
Thank you all, and have a great night.